Hi, I'm Rich Cole at Cole Gunsmithing here in Naples, Florida. In this little video, we're going to show you how we do a leather-covered pad with a nice purdy roll. So what we have here is we've got a nice Perazzi SC3 Sporter that we built for a client. This is a brand new gun. This is a nicely hand-engraved receiver. Really nice gun. And this is the stock, the way it's come from the factory. And so what we're gonna do, I've laid it out. I'm gonna cut it on this yellow line. We're gonna square it up and then we're gonna put a pad on it. We're gonna grind the pad and then we're gonna reduce the size of the pad by the thickness of the leather. And then we're gonna leather cover it. So here's a Cervellotti pad. This is the kind of pad that we use to do the leather covered pads. This is our preference. It's a good effective pad in terms of recoil reduction, and it holds its shape once it's covered in leather real well, as well as the fact that it's quite light. So this is a pad that, you know, that we're the US representatives for Cervellotti, so of course it's branded with our name. But we're not just gonna cover this in leather because that imprint will show through. So here's a pad that I've prepared. I've ground the face of the pad and I've core drilled out the holes for where the screws are gonna go, because after we cover this in leather, we're gonna cover little rubber plugs, and the rubber plugs are gonna go inside so that it makes a nice clean look. Okay, so we've ground our pad and I'm gonna show you the pad. There it is now that it's been ground to fit. We've ground it freehand on a belt sander. And you'll notice that the pad has been ground so that there's just enough of all the way around the pad for the thickness of the leather, all the way around the edge. And we've put a nice graceful radius all the way around, because if we try and bring this to a point, we can't pull the leather around it without having puckers. Okay?
Nobody likes puckers.
No one wants puckers. So the next thing we're going to do is we're going to take our piece of leather. Okay, this is a nice piece of Nigerian goat skin, but it's the way we buy the hides, it's too thick.
Poor goats.
Goats make great leather covered pads, and I understand some people enjoy eating them. In any case, the leather, the way we buy the hides, is between 1 and 2 ounces, and so it's too thick to be able to pull around the pad without big bunches. Okay?
We don't like that.
We don't like that. The other thing is about the leather is that of a hide, there are 4 places of the hide that lend us really, really good leather for leather-covered pads, because the leather has to be very, very elastic. You know, the leather has to have a good stretch to it. So basically, it's just the underarms and in between the legs.
Okay? Of the goat.
Of the goat hide. Right, that's right. The rest of it doesn't stretch well, and it is used for other things. So what we're going to do with this piece of goat skin, which has got the correct characteristic for a leather covered pad, but is too thick, is we're gonna skive it. And this is a skiver. This is actually from a book. These are made in Germany for people that do book binding. And it's got a razor blade on it, and I'm very carefully going to pull that down, and you'll notice that it's cutting my leather thin. So here's the trick. You want to do a good leather-covered pad, either you've got to find leather that's less than an ounce in weight, or you've got to get yourself a way of skiving the leather down. Okay. So we're going to skive this down, and it's going to leave this for us at somewhere under 20/1000ths of an inch thick, and that's about the ideal that we have found that will give us a good looking pad and still have enough thickness that if it's a good quality piece of leather, it's going to be relatively durable. Now these blades will only get basically one pad out of each blade because, you know, the leather itself is abrasive, and in order to cut it like this, the razor has to be very, very sharp. So I go through a lot of razor blades doing this. And I also have to be very careful to stretch it as I'm pulling it, because otherwise if I just put the leather in there and pull it, the edge of the blade will catch it. And it will cut the edge of my leather. It'll make a hole in it. Of course, nobody likes holes either. Okay, I'm going to trim this up, but what I'm going to show you here is thickness-wise. Okay, we're going to put our vernier on it and see where we're at. And there we are. We're right there at 20/1000ths. So that thickness is going to be really good. You can't see through it. Okay? Can't see through any of the pores. So we're not too thin. We're not going to have problems. It's still good and rugged.
Okay? Hold it up to the light again. I missed that.
Did you miss that?
I did that.
You see that?
Yeah.
You see anything through there?
No.
Huh? Okay. Okay, we're getting ready for the next step. Okay, so we've prepared our piece of leather by skiving it down to our 20/1000ths. Here's our piece of leather now. I've wet it, and I've made sure that the piece of leather is completely soaked. You know, I mean, I've really worked the water into it so that it's soaked completely through. This is going to allow me to stretch the leather around the pad that I've put on the stock, and you can see I've put a piece of saran wrap and just sort of taped it so that to keep it from bunching up. This is going to protect my stock from the water because I don't want to put a wet thing on my stock. So I'm going to put my pad, my piece of leather on here. Okay. And I'm going to kind of center it up and get it so that it's even. Okay. Then I'm going to put a rubber band on it to hold it in place. I've tried this a lot of different ways, and I'm sure there are other people that have other ways. I've done hundreds of these pads like this over the years, and I have found that this is to be the easiest, most effective way for me.
Would you like it if somebody gave you a better way?
Oh, I'd like it a lot. Because as people see through us doing this video, it's really quite a lot of work to do one of these.
Maybe someone will watch this and say, Rich, you're making it too much work. We know an easier way.
I hope they'll contact me.
Right.
And let me know.
Right, because it's nice of you to show people how you do it.
I just don't want to hear from the person that says, you know, you shoulda. Okay. So I'm working around this and evening my rubber band up. Okay, sometimes I use a couple rubber bands. It really depends upon, you know, the angles of my leather. as it comes around the heel and the toe. And it depends upon the leather itself. If I need to squeeze it tighter in order to not have puckers in there, I'll use several rubber bands. But if you can see now, come in up and look up close, you can see how nicely we're pulling up around the toe. This is the sharpest point of this, okay? But I've radiused the toe so that the leather will roll around it. I did see in Italy, in Milan, one time on a shopping trip with my wife, we did see a pair of Louis Vuitton shoes. And the way the leather was pulled around the toe of those shoes was absolutely spectacular. And I commented that the individual that was pulling the leather on those shoes would do an excellent job for leather-covered pads. I might note, though, we did not buy the shoes. My wife did not choose the Louis Vuitton shoes. But the prices at Louis Vuitton were enlightening. Okay, so now you see we've gone all the way around our pad and we've got it pulled nice and tight, okay? We're gonna let this dry overnight and let the leather completely dry out. And when it dries, it's gonna shrink ever so slightly, but it's gonna give us a nice form now. So this is what the back end of our pad is actually gonna look like. So it's really shaping up very nicely. Mm-hmm. And we'll do the rest of it tomorrow. So here we are. We've got our leather covered pad that's been pulled, and we let that dry overnight. And what I was doing is getting the few tools that I use to do this next section of this. And I was looking for my good little pair of these scissors, nice Italian steel scissors. And lo and behold, I found them on the bench of another one of the gunsmiths here. So I was mentioning to him that when I was a much younger man, as a gunsmith apprentice, Beretta had the expectation that I would buy my own tools. So anyway, we mentioned that. I think he failed to see the humor. We'll follow up with that later. But in any case, so I'm gonna take my dry piece of leather off, okay? And you can see now what we've got is we've got a nice mold of my leather pad. You know, so that fits very, very nicely. And what by wetting this and pulling this and letting it dry, I've got a nice mold. It's going to prevent puckers around the edge that we would get if we hadn't taken this step. So what we're going to do is we're going to take the pad off the gun now and using some contact cement, we're going to partially attach of leather to our pad, but we're not going to contact cement the whole thing. Okay, we're only going to contact cement part of it. We'll be back.
Hi, Walter. Hi, Betty. What are you doing?
You're a good boy. Yes, you're my buddy. Okay.
He's underfoot.
Yeah. So we've applied the contact cement to the face of the leather pad, and as well as to the inside of the holes. Not all over the leather, but just on the face of where it is. Now, what we've got to do is we've got to get this on here and got to be pretty careful with it because we need to get it exactly in the right place. Because once that contact cement really bonds, you're not going to move it without ruining it, okay? So there we go, just like putting on a pair of socks, okay? Now, what I'm doing here is I'm rubbing where the holes are so that I can see them because we've got to cut these holes and we've got to hit the right place. So you can see where they are now. And I'm gonna use my light so that I can see them from an angle very, very nicely. I'm taking a really, really sharp razor knife
and very, very carefully splitting just the inside of this, because we're going to fold the leather back up into the hole, and we want it to bond to the leather on the inside, I mean, to the rubber on the inside. So we're basically cutting this just like a pie. The X-Acto knife has to be really sharp in order to do this. And then we're going to work our way around the edge and push that up in. I was very, very careful not to make cuts that are going to be outside the edge of where my plug is going to be there on the inside, because we want it to look nice. Okay, and the same thing down here on the bottom. Just like cutting grandma's pie. Push that up in there, kind of roll the handle around and sort of use it as a press to push that up in there. And now we're going to take the pad off.
Oh, yeah, that'd be
go. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to trim the pad around, okay, and I'm going to cut it with little triangles here so that we can pull it all the way around the edge, and then I'm going to treat this with contact cement, okay? So I've trimmed all the way around my pad now, gotten rid of the excess leather, and basically notched it all the way around where there's a radius and it needs to be pulled smaller. I've got my contact cement on both surfaces. Okay, so what we're gonna do is we're gonna start up here at the top, and we're gonna very carefully start pulling these towards the edge. Okay. And we just have to work around it very, very carefully, because what we want to do is we want to be very, very even as far as the way that the leather pulls, so that we don't end up with any bunches. And that's really the trick. You see the little bunch starting to form there? I have to work around that bunch. There we go. You see that?
No puckers.
No bunches. No puckers, no bunches. I want it to be a nice, even look all the way around.
You have to hold your tongue just right?
Yeah. Yeah, the tongue. The tongue's got to be held just right. I know I've heard that I make some very unusual faces, and I'm not that handsome a fella to start with, so I think that. But then I went, nobody's ever going to pay me for what I look like, okay? So, and now we're going to do the toe. The toe is the most challenging part. So, of course, I leave it for the last. And I'm just going to, I'm not sticking my leather to the pad completely. I'm kind of working my way around and sort of getting it started so that I can see how it's,
because it's sort of how it wants to pull.
That's right. So I'm going to stick that one there. We're going to be good. There we go.
After I'm videotaping you, I worry because I'm worried that you'll swear.
I don't swear.
Mess up a perfectly good video.
Perfectly good video. I'll bet the people.
Kyle,
that,
does he ever swear?
I plead the fifth.
I bet the people that watch this video far more interested in what I'm doing than what I'm saying.
Do you think people find this interesting, what it is that you're doing?
Well, I wouldn't, but then again, I've been doing it for 40 years now, so, you know.
I enjoy that.
I enjoy it a lot.
I see a pucker.
The pucker's gonna go away.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you worry about showing people how to do this so that then they can do this and they won't need you?
And they won't need me?
Mm-hmm.
No.
That's what you're going for.
Because, well, you know, I've been trying to retire for how long now?
Mm-hmm.
Or at least semi-retire. So now what I'm doing, you can see I'm going around with my nice special pliers here, and I'm working this edge down all the way around. And if I've done a good job of basically trimming, then I don't end up with any pieces bunching over and creating a thick spot in the pad.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and...
Because that's happened before.
Well, I've made all the mistakes. You know, the reason I know how to do this is because I've done it all wrong. Okay, and I feel like anybody, if you do something enough, if you don't get pretty good at it, you're a failure. You might as well find something else to do, okay? I mean, truly, truly. You know, after enough time and enough efforts, if a person doesn't get good at something, you better find something else to do. Okay, there we go. Now, I'm just going to kind of carefully go around my edge here. And there we go.
Shoes.
It's just like the toe on that Louis Vuitton shoe.
Louis Vuitton would hire you.
Yeah.
Or not.
Okay, so last but not least.
I'm glad you just had a filter. I just saw the filter develop.
What we have here is we've got our little plugs, okay? And you can see I've made little red crosses out of my leather, and I have these rubber plugs that we've core drilled. And the core drill that I use for the pad, okay, we have taken into consideration the leather thickness so that the hole in the pad size and the diameter of the plug match when we fold the leather through both sides. So I'm gonna stick that to that one, fold that on. Okay.
It's not as easy as it seems.
Well, that's why I say if somebody wants to do this on their own so they don't need me, you know, have at it. Go bonkers. You'll find that I'm a pretty good value after you've done this on your own. So there are our plugs, okay, that are gonna go in there. Now, the last thing that we're gonna do is we're gonna put our nice little Purdy rolls on there. So we'll be right back. So we're gonna put our rolls on. Basically what I have is I have a soldering iron that has been made into a device that is a specific distance from my little table. And I'm carefully rolling my pad around and sort of branding in my decorative line. And we'll have two lines on here. Okay, so I'm going to put a spacer in now to space. And we're just working around this.
That smells hot, so that's hot.
This is hot. It's very hot. It's a medium-sized soldering iron, and I've, you know, made this fixture for it. And
the last time I saw you do this, you were not using this approach. You were doing something else.
Well, I think that there are different ways of making these lines, but it's perfectly predictable. I mean, you can see that the lines are perfectly spaced.
And
all
that
the way around.
Just a finishing touch.
This is just a decoration.
Pleasing to some folks.
That's right.
It's called a Purdy roll.
It's, I've always heard it referred to as a Purdy roll. And frankly, not being a an astute scholar, studied of British guns, I truly couldn't tell you.
So here's our nice Perazzi SC3 that we had built for one of our customers, a nice brand new gun. And we've got our leather covered pad installed on it with our decorative rolls and the plugs. And that's how we do a leather covered pad. So if you want to give it a try yourself, good luck. Have right at it.